Discover.
Welcome back. I'd like to introduce you again to the CDB Masters who are joining us for this second episode. They're going to introduce themselves to you by, again, sharing their be-all and their goal. So let's begin with Michael.
Hi, I'm Michael Thurlor, and my be-all is to reach financial freedom and study with the best minds in the world and bring that back to energetic people. And my number one goal is to build business builders and young living and establish that and go forward with it.
Wonderful.
Hi, I'm Tara Rayburn, and my be-all is to create healthy ripples worldwide. And as a measure of that, to create a benevolence fund, $1 million benevolence fund to use as in ways that God puts in my heart. And the goal, the number one goal I'm focusing on is the creation of the Healthy Habit Coach.
Thank you so much.
My name is Corey Stallings. My be-all is to start my own entertainment company. And my goal is to attract like-minded individuals who are living in their integrity and their passion of their art and unwilling to compromise for a compensation.
Great. Wonderful.
Hi, my name is Valerie Malotti. My be-all is to assist people in making educated choices about their health and their treatments. And my goal towards achieving my be-all is to educate myself about natural health options and treatments that are available.
Fantastic. And I'm Stacey Hall, again, your coach and facilitator, and my be-all is to achieve all the licenses and certifications to be able to call myself a doctor of natural medicine. And my number one goal today in this moment is to support you and all the CDB Masters who are here with me today in being able to achieve all of your be-alls. So the second energy surge that's very important for me to share, the first being scheduling for success, that's the scheduling of your intentional activities. The second is do it your way, any way you can. Do it your way, any way you can. And that comes from one of my most favorite motivational inspirers, Zig Ziglar. So Zig, wherever you are, I send you love and appreciation for something you said when I attended a seminar that you gave years and years ago in Houston, and you came out on the stage, and the first thing you said was, anything worth doing, and I thought I knew how he was going to end it, but I didn't, anything worth doing is worth doing poorly the first time. And I can tell you that those words rocked my world. Because up until that point, I was a perfectionist. That didn't mean I was perfect. In fact, I knew darn well I was not. So I was constantly in a state of putting myself down because my aim was for perfection and I wasn't. And I'm just curious, anyone in the room resemble this remark? I'm the only
Absolutely.
One in the world who is
no,
like
not
this.
At all, really.
Okay. Yeah. No, can't imagine what I'm talking about. No, because what I found is people who are up to something big, they're up to something big because they can see a more perfect world, a more perfect way of being. And yet, again, this concept of try and fail. Oh, that just, I was truly constantly, you talk about a monkey swinging in the tree. No, I was a hamster, you know, going round and round the wheel. And I still talking about it, I can remember the tears that came to my eyes and the sense of relief that I was given. It was like somebody exploded dynamite in my belief system. And I could see clearly for the first time of how ridiculous it had been to think that the first time I was going to learn how to do something, I'd do it perfectly. And why I did so little, why I had so many desires and wishes and dreams, but did so little because I was frozen, knowing that I didn't know how to do it. And the few times that I actually, because for whatever reason, it was important or it was required or whatever, that I actually did accomplish something, it was because I asked somebody for help. But I always felt less than when I did that. Does this make sense to you?
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes.
So when Zig Ziglar uttered those magic words, and for me, they were absolutely magic words, I gave myself the freedom from that moment forth that I was going to do everything I did poorly the first time. It, you know, being perfection, I had to go way to one extreme in order to come back to the other. But I just did. I delighted in that concept of I can do anything I want, knowing that the first time I do it, it's going to be really poor. And then, of course, if it was better than that, it was a treat, but really poor. And the second time I did it, I would learn from what I did the first time and do it a little bit better and a little bit better and a little bit better. And eventually I would get there. That's why this is the second energy surge of the Chi to Be program. Because going back to the concept of choosing a be-all, identifying goals, setting intentional activities, all of this may be the first time that you've ever looked at goal setting in this way. And you may not feel 100% comfortable with it yet. Good. Do it poorly, as Zig Ziglar would say, or as I say, do it your way, any way you can. Little by little, the more you listen to these recordings, it will become second nature to you. Corey, your experience when you were first introduced to this, and how does it feel now?
Oh, well, I'm a lot more comfortable than when I first was introduced to it. Most definitely. I mean, when we first started, I definitely did many things poorly. but yes, with the reoccurrence of it, you know, you learn from where you didn't do so well at first, and then you continue to build, you continue to grow. So especially with my, the most important thing to me is to learn. That's been a huge experience for me, and I just enjoy it. I enjoy the learning process. So.
Wonderful. Thank you for sharing. Anybody else have thoughts about, do you remember what it was like when you first learned? I remember when I was sharing them with each of you the first time and some of the comments you made to me, but rather than speak for you, do you remember what you said? And then how do you feel now about the process?
It teaches you to come out of your comfort zone where you wouldn't approach this before. And when you, because that wasn't in my vocabulary, if I couldn't do it well, I didn't want to do it. So I had to learn to take baby steps to do this and discovered it was okay. When it's okay, you take your steps and you progressively go up the ladder and you free up your energy and you take, again, the overwhelm away.
Wonderful. So you had the same experience as I had in the past.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I don't think Michael and I are the only two people in the world that were taught that if you can't do it right, don't do it at all, or don't expect to do it well, but don't expect to be encouraged or appreciated if you don't do it completely well. Tara, you just nodded, I noticed.
Oh, I completely resonate with the whole perfectionism thing, which I'm sure a lot of people do. But I know that that has held me back in the past. And the interesting thing is that's given me freedom now to do some other things that I let myself off the hook. I don't have to be perfect that first time. But also to look back at like the first time I ever spoke in front of a group, you know, not in school. And I was speaking to an allergy support group and I read it from the paper. And I was terrible. I was not speaking from my heart. I felt horrible about it.
And wait a second. Who said you were terrible?
Oh, I felt. I did videotape it and I watched it, which was good because I grew. But learning this was like, you know what? That was my first time. And I, after all those years, let myself off the hook. But the key was that I was still kind of letting that hold on to me so that it made it a little trickier to try new things. And so when you said you had something shatter and explode inside you, I felt that same thing. And I felt this release of that old experience and I had to laugh. I was like, my gosh, that was my first time. I was, you know, very nervous. Gosh, move on. And so I really resonate with what you said.
Fabulous. And I would say now when you look at it, do you still feel like you were terrible, or in light of what you had available to you at the time, the fact it was your first time, how more could you speak to yourself so that you can actually be empowered from the experience?
I was doing the best I could. I really was.
Yeah. And what did you learn from it?
Well, I learned on all different levels, you know, what I could do to become better at speaking, and more importantly, to be gentle with myself, because beating myself up was not, that doesn't accomplish anything, you know, but being gentle and going, oh, it's all right, and moving on, boy, I got a lot more energy from doing that, a whole lot more.
Right. Absolutely. That gentleness with ourselves, that appreciation for ourselves, we'll be talking a lot more about that in the coming episodes. And just one final thought, how would you say now that experience propelled you forward towards the achievement of your be-all?
Because the reason why I was up there doing that speech was to help other people, to help people who were going through the same storm. I'm going to get choked up on that, that I've been through with my family. And the reason that I was doing it wasn't about me. It was, but it wasn't. It was to help people. And that's exactly why I'm doing what I'm doing today.
Beautiful. Take a big deep breath on that for all of us. So those of you listening, I'm going to invite you to take a quiet moment now and think about something you would do towards your goal, or even directly towards your be-all, that given the freedom to not have to do it perfectly the first time, you now feel like you could take some intentional step, some intentional activity towards that. We're going to go into the third energy surge, tending your be-all garden. And it goes right along with do it your way, any way you can. And it's a wonderful way of tracking how far our intentional activities take us closer to the goal, which ultimately takes us closer to the fulfillment of the be-all. And it's not a new concept. I want to be absolutely clear. Many people have spoken about this because it is such an integral part of creation. Any type of the big creation of the world, if you will, the way our lives go. Tara talked about the concept of things circulating, being circular and going around and around. Well, tending to our be-all garden is, again, a circular experience. It is exactly the way gardens grow. And when we apply that concept to the fulfillment of a goal, it takes away the concepts that have been out there about from business and that everything only goes in one direction. Well, let me put it this way, two directions, up or down. Up equals good, down equals bad. But what if there was no up and down? What if there only was a cycle? And every cycle has its stages. And I see all the Chi to Be masters nodding their heads on this one. So Valerie, before we even tell everyone what the cycles are, how has tending your be-all garden made a difference for you?
The biggest thing for me is just being able to celebrate instead of looking at, is this good or is this bad? It's everything is a celebration and it's leading to something else. and to growth.
Beautiful. And I say beautiful because I feel the same way. It's before, if I was going up, I was happy. If I felt that things were going down or stagnant, I was unhappy. Now, that unhappiness doesn't even enter my life. If something looks like it's stagnant or not moving forward, I just say, okay, then I must be in a new stage. So together, let's look at the stages of tending your be-all garden. As with any garden, what does it start with? Corey, what does a garden start with?
Seeds.
A seed. Exactly. Seeds. Actually, if you're just going to have one flower, a seed. If you're going to have an entire garden, then yes, lots of seeds. And that is what goals are for our be-all. The be-all is the whole entire garden, the plot, if you will, in which our garden is growing. And the number of goals are the different types of flowers or plants or herbs. And I'm going to say herbs as well for the people. I've never known if it's herbs or herbs. So now I've just covered all the bases. But you know what I'm saying. All of those plants that are going to grow in the same garden. In sometimes they have to grow separate from each other. And sometimes all intermingled. With that said, everything starts with the seed. And in the seeding process, is there a little bit of energy expended or a lot of energy expended? Anyone?
A lot.
Tara, go ahead, Tara, why?
Well, part of that is preparing the soil. Mm-hmm. And you and I have talked about that before, and that's something I really resonate with, is when our soil is prepared properly, that's a huge chunk of the battle. If you have healthy soil for those seeds to grow, if it's in a good location, if it's, you know, if you've done what it takes to prepare that soil, boy, those seeds can really grow a lot better.
Absolutely. So that's the planning before anything takes place. We a goal pops into our mind, a lot of planning, and not just planning to be able to get that seed to sprout, right? The planning has to be in there during the seeding process for the entire growth cycle, the entire growth cycle. How is that soil going to support not just a little sprout, but lots of goals, all sprouting, blossoming at different times of the year, maybe sometimes almost all at once. All the resources, the tools, the resources, the energy required to keep that garden blossoming. Because sometimes things will be in blossom, plants will be in blossom, and at the same time, other plants will be lying fallow, right? It won't be their growing season, so they'll be at rest. It's very rare in a beautiful garden that everything would be dried up and not flourishing at the same time. Would you agree? If that was it, we would say the garden was dead. Yes?
Yes.
So to make the most beautiful garden, we want to make sure that we've got something growing all the time. Doesn't always have to be, not all plants produce flowers, but they definitely all come into their fullness. Would you agree with that?
Yes.
Okay. That's why I call it the be-all garden, not the goal garden. Because when we look at the be-all, the planning that has to take place are listing out all the goals. Up to now, we've just talked about one or two goals to get the practice of doing so. And because we were learning how to do it our way, any way we could. But as we develop the ability to identify more goals, set up more intentional activities to support those goals, we can expand our garden and the number of goals that we can manage at the same time in order to ultimately have the be-all faster. Does this make sense?
Yes.
Okay, how so, Corey? How is this making sense so far?
Well, I love analogies, so it helps me to put things in perspective as far as having the whole garden and the be-all just being everything that entails the whole garden. And yeah, the goals being the different seeds and how to get there. So it just makes visual sense to me because I can visualize it.
Beautiful. So. Beautiful. Michael, for you, is it making sense?
Yes, we all go through different stages of our life. And then when we're seeding and blooming or wherever we may be, and for one part to start, another part has to step in. And sometimes you have to get to a point where you have to gestate, just let it rest. And then the sprout comes up.
Yes.
So.
Yes, absolutely. So that's the overall concept. Now we'll get into the more specifics. So going back to what Tara had mentioned about the planning that takes place in the seeding process, even before the seed is in the ground, we do have to map out the territory, if you will, the amount of space we're going to give to the garden. And we also probably want to plan out where the tomato plant's going to go and where the rose is going to go and will they grow in this kind of a soil with this and in this kind of shade or that kind of sun. All of that goes into landscaping a garden. Yes?
Yes.
Okay. Same with planning out the be-all. The time to know whether we have enough resources to sustain a long blooming cycle is not in the blooming cycle, which is where most people generally plan it. So let's go through the stages. So it's seeding, sprouting, blossoming, and as Michael said, resting. Those are the four stages of goal development. And the seeding stage is the place where we want to plan for every one of the sprouting, blossoming, and resting stages of each goal. Right? When we're going to implement the goals, what's going to be required to bring that goal into a place where we can see it starting to develop. Then once it's fully developed, what are we going to need in terms of support? And then when it's ready to rest, being prepared that it will rest. As we're recording this, it's still considered winter in Las Vegas, which is where we are. I have a beautiful rose garden. My husband planted beautiful roses for me. There is not one blossoming right now. Is my garden dead?
No.
No, it's just not the season. And yet, oftentimes, what I find with people is when a goal stops producing for a little bit, it's that the world's coming to an end. And the reason being is they did not plan for the fact that some plants just don't keep blossoming over and over again. They've got to rest. And with roses, we have to cut them all the way back. Everybody has to cut them all the way back after they've bloomed. Anybody who cultivates roses know you cut them all the way back to the stalk. So that when it blooms again, you get a bigger rose. It's the same thing with grapes. After there has been a harvest, they don't leave those long, spindly little, I can't even call them branches, they're so spindly. You have to cut them back all the way to the stalk and replenish, re-nourish. And when they grow out again, those grapes will be big and full and juicy. And so those who tend vineyards, once they've had a harvest, if everything else is fine, unless something has happened dramatically to cause maybe a flood and the plants have been, seeds have been washed away. If it's just a normal growth cycle, they know those grapes aren't going to keep growing all year long. So they plan for that. But most people, when they're doing, let's use a more powerful word than that, when they are growing a goal, they don't take into account that there will be times when that goal will have to be at rest. And for me, that's usually when they come to me for coaching, because they want to know what they've done wrong. I was getting money, I was getting clients, it was working. How come it's not still working? Well, there can be a thousand reasons for it, but usually what I find is that it was time for it to rest, for other goals to be given attention. And that's the beauty when we have a be-all garden, our focus isn't just on one goal. The goal doesn't become the be-all and the end-all of our lives. The be-all is, and the be-all requires lots of goals. Now that was kind of a tongue twister. Did that make sense, Valerie? Yeah. What did you hear me say in that?
That the focus is all of the parts of your garden and how it works together rather than just one single flower. If we had just planted that one seed, like we talked about in the very beginning, then that would have been everything. Our whole garden would be all about that one seed. But because we've planted so many seeds, because there are so many goals that are involved in achieving our be-all, it's very exciting because we're always in a stage of growth. And I was particularly affected by the rest stop. I was one of those people who would get to a certain point and then go, wait, what? What's going on? And so the rest stop is now a time that I celebrate more than any of the others. I find that to be a more exciting time because what's going to happen next is what I'm anticipating and celebrating. Whereas a blossom, although it's beautiful and it's a celebration in itself, it's already out there. It's already in fruition. And so for me, there's an excitement now in the rest stop rather than a fear that comes up.
I love that. Corey, do you have a favorite stage?
Do I have a favorite stage? No, I don't have a favorite stage. But I can share with you something that just opened up for me.
Absolutely.
I just realized, I don't know, not necessarily my garden getting bigger, but the cycles in which things occur. Because as Valerie just touched on, she said the resting cycle used to be a big, you know, red flag for her. And I've been having an issue as far as writing my music. It's been a huge, I wouldn't even call it a writer's block. I've had a writer's block, but recently it's just been like, no, like I go to write and it's just like, no, now's not the time. And I'm just realized like, oh, right now is resting cycle. Because it is time for me to implement a lot of other things. As far as the music goes, lyrically, the flowers bloomed, but there's some other things that I need to work on sprouting that have been seeded that I get to work on right now.
Yay. I'm going to applaud on that. That's perfect. What a beautiful, both of you. Thank you so much for giving back to me the concept in some very tangible ways that you're envisioning it. So I'm delighted. That's exactly true. You've got these other goals in your garden that you now are given time to go tend to.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful. Tara, a favorite?
Well, I do have a favorite, but with what Valerie and Corey just said, what occurs to me is a well-planned garden, those different, the be-all garden, all the different goals are symbiotic. They help us get to that be-all. So when you're resting in one and you're going to another, it just really hit me as they were speaking that, wow, these other goals, you know, they are also getting us to the same place, but they're symbiotic. And as far as favorite is resting. Totally. It actually gives me permission to rest. And I know I don't need that. But, you know, I've just been going for so many years. And I think our culture's like that. I watch, you know, and we all have a tendency to be that way. And I know I do. And so this is actually a beautiful analogy that just allows me to know that resting still is able to, if anything, it's essential for me to continue and to create the things in life and the events in life and all that. And so I absolutely, the whole analogy works great, but resting is definitely my favorite.
And I'm going to say it's essential for you to be able to give yourself that permission. This is what I hear, to rest as well as your goal resting. It's also essential to the goal. The ground needs to stop, rest for a bit, get more nourishment, more nutrients, and let those seeds develop in their natural time. Natural time is a big concept for me that we're going to explore, not in this audio series, but in the mastery audio series that comes. In the meantime, we can practice with natural time just by moving through the cycles of growth in the tending of our be-all garden. Michael, favorite?
Appreciation for each stage. The more you appreciate, the more you bring into your life. And I learned the hard way on the gestation part, where just resting. And That's why I have so much hair up here.
You can't see. Michael is referring to the fact that his scalp is a little shiny.
So anyway, the appreciation, I think, is probably one of the most wonderful words that we can come up with, because when you appreciate each and every stage, you're able to love it, nurture it, and bring it forward and empower it.
Beautiful. I do my best not to have a favorite, and just saying that, you can all hear I obviously do. It's a little bit like, I love all my children. There's in this particular energy surge, I would say I get the most excitement out of the sprout. When I know that all that time and effort I put in at the front end, where nothing may be showing up, nothing, for a very long time, where I may be the only one who believes that this goal is actually going to come to fruition. I am the only one. I see people nodding. I'm obviously not the only one. You know what I'm talking about. That's what the seeding stage is about. It's that visioning, holding the intention that something's going to happen. And I've learned over the course of my life that if I hold it tightly enough, if I see it clearly enough, there's many, many, many books on manifesting what we desire. That's what I call the seeding part of it. But when it actually starts to show up and pop its head out of the ground, that's when I exhale. And I say, okay, now my work's not over. You know, I know in some ways my work is just beginning, because just to get that sprout to show up took a lot of energy. Would you all agree with that? Yes. Takes a lot of energy to do nothing. The planning, which is not nothing, but a lot of it is energetic, intentional activity. Sometimes that is so much energy depleting, so much more energy depleting than actual tangible intentional activities. Which is why it's very important during the seeding stage to not just tend to the goal, but also to tend to myself as the manifester of that goal. But then once that sprout comes up, it's almost as if I can take maybe a day and just go, oh, I'm just going to celebrate. I knew that seed was going to produce something. I knew it. And see, and now I can show everybody, see, I told you it was going to produce. And kind of have that big cheerleading, chest proud moment. And then from that point on, if my plans have been well laid, and it's not too late, even in the sprouting stage, there's still adjustments I'm able to make. If I start to see that not all the sprouts are coming up like I expected, okay, that one did and that one did, but where are those other 15? Okay, maybe there's some more adjustments I have to make, but at least I've got the proof that I was on the right track. And then once the blossoms come, is that the time to rest? Can you rest when it's blossoming?
Not yet.
Not yet. Why not, Valerie? Yeah, why not?
There's the harvest.
And what about the harvest?
The blossoming is, although it's the most exciting in some ways, I think that one is the most work.
It really is for me too. You tell me why, and then I'll tell you why I think so.
Well, if it's fruit or vegetables, you've got harvesting to do, and then there's consuming what you've harvested, whether you're going to can it or consume it right away, or turn it into something else. If it's blossoms, they're not going to last forever. So it's tending to them and their needs to give them exactly what they need to be the fullest they can be. So it's a lot of work attention.
Absolutely. And that's just if we're only working with one goal. Now, imagine you've got a goal, and we're going to keep the flowering going on, and then I'll bring it back for everybody who's saying, okay, enough of the flowers already. Just stay with me here for a moment. Imagine you've got one part of your garden fully blooming, but now you've got another part starting to sprout. Mm-hmm. Okay, which do you tend to first? And that's the way most people look at it. I have to choose between one or the other because I didn't plan for that. I didn't plan for them to be all working at the same time. So here's the specifics. I have a variety of elements to my business, CDBaby. I am a licensed spiritual healer, certified aromatherapy coach. I do raindrop technique facilitation sessions, which is essential oil anointing. I do life coaching. Here I am, an author and the developer of a whole coaching program. Okay. Now, some clients work with me in all of that. Most do not. Most come to me from one element or another. And so I have different goals for each one of those. How many raindrop sessions I'm going to do in a week, because they are more labor intensive and time intensive. How many life coaching sessions can I do in person and or by phone? It's not one goal. My BL is to be a doctor of natural medicine. How I structure working with each one of the techniques and the services I provide is actually its own goal. I also represent an essential oils company. All right, I've got goals for that as well, for sales. Each of those are goals. So at the moment, I can tell you that very few of my goals are lying fallow. They're all either being seeded, sprouting, or blossoming. And yes, could I feel like a one-armed paper hanger, or I'm not sure what the analogy would be towards the gardener there, but at times, unless I hadn't planned ahead of time what was going to happen. So first goal starts to sprout and I start bringing in financial compensation. I can handle the bookkeeping part of it. Right? It's not that difficult. I can make the entries. I can keep up. My husband and I, he does the taxes for us. I just have to keep the receipts. He puts it into the computer. I get to the bank. When I get to the bank, it works. Well, now I'm getting more financial compensation because another goal is starting to develop and blossom. All right, now there's more money coming in. A beautiful issue to have, right? Would you all agree?
Very nice.
Okay, this is, we're not talking about, right now, I'm not talking about the challenges that might also come up. I'm talking about the things we really want to see happen. So here comes more money. But at the same time, I'm now also responding to people who have questions about essential oils. I've got coaching sessions that I want to do in order to keep that money coming in. I've got a book to write to finish. This all happened while we were developing this program. I'm scheduling the audio session to do this. I'm developing my website. All of a sudden, bookkeeping going to go by the wayside. But if I don't keep up with my bookkeeping, I'm going to have problems down the road. Would you agree with that?
Yes.
In many, many ways. I better have planned for this back in seeding. But here's what happens that I've experienced for my clients and in the past when I didn't do this. Now all of a sudden, all this wonderful, great response, result, blossoms are happening, sprouts are happening, but they're not producing enough income yet or as much income as I would want before I go to hire somebody. Because I didn't plan for the fact that that was going to happen early on. And then we have people then who are trying to do it all. And I did use the word intentionally trying, because if they weren't considering that they were going to do it poorly the first time, then they're probably in this state. And you're all nodding. What's opening up for you? Tara, you're nodding the biggest at the moment. What are you noticing?
Well, boy, there's just so much there. I know that years ago, I worked with my husband and I was really not wanting to relinquish my responsibilities because I felt very territorial. This is our finances, you know, whatever I wanted to come up with that. And my husband always said, he said, when you hire someone to get you out of that place, they actually make you money. But it was a mindset I was dealing with. And I hear those words because he was right. We hired someone and we've had fabulous experiences with the people we've hired. It's been tremendous. And now I'm in the place where I have many, many beautiful things happening in my garden. And I recognize that I can try to do it all poorly the first time, or I can learn from that lesson and start to field and see what other gardeners I can have help do certain tasks so that I can focus on the overall picture. Because when I let that garden get too out of control, that's where I get into overwhelm and different things. And so, I mean, there's just so many aspects to this analogy that just really, I love it. It just helps me a whole lot.
Beautiful. Tara, thank you so much for sharing your experience about tending the garden.
No problem.
Again, the blooming stage is the most intensive, and it can be the most fun if we remember to plan for that stage back in the seeding stage. So I had mentioned planning for bookkeeping. If we want to have an abundance of money, if we intend to have an abundance of money, how are we going to manage that abundance of money? If our intention is to be able to be serving lots and lots of customers, how are we going to manage serving all those customers along with every other goal that we have put together for ourselves to achieve towards our be-all? If we are, I'm thinking about something else because mostly this is business. So Valerie, I'm going to use you as an example.
Okay.
Let's say in the blooming stage, we're having a third child. Okay. You and your husband are having a third child. And in that literal seeding stage.
Indeed.
Right. You have not planned for what that's going to be like. You've already got lots of activities with two toddlers in the house,
Indeed.
You know, two children under the age of four, one more coming. Here comes the blooming stage. You've now given birth, right? There we are. And it may be a while before that goal rests. You won't be pregnant any longer. And yet you're going to be in the next stage of the goal. If you haven't planned for how you're going to manage a household of three children, that could be a little overwhelming at that moment. Would you agree?
I agree.
Okay, can you share a little more about that? What do you see for yourself in that?
I believe that's one of the reasons we are pregnant for 9 months. So we have some time for that planning and the adjustment. Obviously, the dynamics of the entire household will change when you introduce another being. And the preparations of having my shape-shifting body take place and feeling the baby moving, giving my kids a chance to celebrate and enjoy what's to come is a big part of it right now. As I get closer to the end of my pregnancy, then I'm going to be thinking more about the logistics of running a household with three kids, of making sure that I have clothing prepared and make sure that I'm ready to jump in and nurse and still care for my toddlers who have their needs as well. So I'm going to be enlisting some support from other people. I'm going to be talking to my husband, my mother. We have a wonderful babysitter and she's going to be prepared for the fact that there's going to be another person. So I believe in nature. You're given time, and I have the opportunity to make all of those preparations, and I certainly will be doing that, and will be thinking of that over the next 7 months.
And I, too, believe that nature gives us all the time that's required to bring something through. It's only if I choose to not follow nature's time. Any creation is a natural part of nature, in my opinion. Whether it is a business goal or a personal goal. And in my world, they really fall one together. They're simultaneous tied. Almost very, very difficult to say something is completely a business goal because it's going to have an impact on our personal lives, or something is a completely a personal goal because it's going to have an impact on our business life. Yes? Agreed?
Yes, indeed.
Okay. And seeding, if we thought about tending to the be-all garden and applied also the concept of growing a human being, that seeding would take at least 9 months. How many of us, and I hold myself accountable here too, how many of us would say that we would be patient in the seeding process to just sit and plan for 9 months with nothing else going on except being in the space of continuing to think about the goal with doing nothing against it. How many of us are that patient? I cannot put my own hand up. Yeah. Other than one that's imposed where Valerie is saying nature's requiring her for her to have a happy, healthy baby, she's got to be in the seeding stage for 9 months. Indeed. Do you apply it to other goals in your life, Valerie?
I do apply it to other goals. But what helps me is I have other goals where I can apply other stages. I can apply other activities. So I'm not just in a waiting phase on every single goal. But I do see that 9 months is an interesting amount of time and that there is a significant cycle that occurs in 9 months in other aspects of my life other than pregnancy.
Right. Right. Michael, was there something you wanted to add to that?
No, you have to have patience and let things happen. And everything happens for a reason. And when we get in touch with the self and we go up to the source, he comes down and reveals it to us in the proper time, in the proper place.
Proper way. Now, I will say some goals take a lot longer than 9 months. So when I say I'm not always that patient, that's true. Because once I start to get an idea, I like to run with it. On the other hand, just this CDBaby program, actually, it was 6 years in the making. That didn't mean I didn't take any intentional activity towards it. And I would say there were elements within me on a personal level, on a energy strength level. My health was not very good 6 years ago. I talk about that in the introduction to CDBaby, the book. And I had the idea for this program. There were other goals that required my attention before I could actually start to take activity, plan activity, such as attracting clients. Long before I was able to attract clients, I had to first get my own health in order. So that was the first goal. And planning how I was going to do that took quite a bit of time as well.
I enjoy the quote, it took them 10 years to be an overnight success.
Yes, yes. And the more planning, the less time. I was thinking of this quote the other day as I was finishing the book. If I had more time, I'd write less. And it came back to me, and for me, it feels the same way. If I had more time to plan, I would be less active. It would take less activity to bring about what I desire. Does this make sense?
Indeed, yeah. Yes.
Okay, great. As we come to the end of our discussion on blooming our goals, tending to our goals, we do want to take a look at the rest period. Before we go into the rest period, I want to come back to one more aspect of blooming. And that is, for me personally, without the first two energy surges of scheduling for success and doing it my way, any way I can, doing it your way, any way you can, I would have a much more difficult time when my goals turn into the blossoming stage. Blossoming requires much scheduling. Much intentional scheduling and much intentional scheduling to eliminate wasteful activities. When activities simply involve me, I have an easier time of knowing whether something's going to be an energy waster or an energy generator. When activities involve people who seem at first to be aligned with me or aligned with that goal, I get very excited and I want to be able to meet with them and see what we can co-create. I do this a lot. I love co-creation. But oftentimes, more times often than not, and much less now that I have implemented the tip that I'm about to share with you, in the past, more times often than not, I would have a meeting with someone expecting that we had the same goal in mind, same intention for getting together, only to find out that was not the case. So perhaps I was expecting that they would be an investor. I talked with them briefly. I had said that I wanted an investor in a project. And what they heard was that I was going to coach them for free or something ridiculous about that. And I can see by your faces, you're saying you know what I'm talking about in your own lives. Intentional activities are with other people are far more productive if before we enter deeply into the relationship, we set our intention right up front. If I'm going to schedule this time with you, this would be the result I would want to work towards. And when I share this with people at first, they will often say to me, well, I you know, that's kind of bold. No, it's not kind of bold. It's darn bold. Because I know that when I get to the blossoming stage, there won't be any time to waste. Every activity has to be essentially productive and prosperous. So when I'm seeding a relationship, if you will, towards the fulfillment of the goal, my way of seeding is I'm putting the seed into the ground. Are you going to help me plant the seed, or did you want to plant a different seed in another part of my garden? Or do you want me to put a seed into your garden? Because if so, I'm not sure. That garden really has to be very similar to mine. And maybe we can extend the territory together and combine our gardens. I'm really getting into the metaphor here, aren't I? And yet I can see in your eyes that you're saying you understand what I'm saying. So have any of you experienced a time where you thought you were sure that the two of you were absolutely aligned, whatever this person was that you were creating with, and it didn't go where you expected, kind of took you off onto a detour where you were planting their garden and your garden got forgotten for a little bit? Has that ever happened to you? Corey's saying, uh-huh.
Yes.
What's coming back to you here?
Okay. The situation was there was an agreement between me and another gentleman where I was going to assist in the engineering in the studio back in Philadelphia. And in exchange for that, I was going to get X amount of recording time. Every day, my recording time continued to go on the back burner. So there was just two different seeds that, you know, weren't adding up. And it took a lot of energy away from me. And it took a lot of time away. Yet I look at it now and I learned a lot from the experience. I learned that I wasn't very clear up front as to what I was expecting from the situation. And I also learned how to avoid that. Yeah.
Anything worth doing is worth doing poorly the first time.
Yeah.
As long as we're learning from it and continue to improve. From the benefit of all of our experience, we offer to you, those of you who are listening, to please be clear with why you want to meet with somebody or why you want to do a particular project or activity. And if it involves someone else, be very clear with them what is the intended result you are working towards, you're intending to achieve. Then they have the clear choice. They can say, great, love it, let's do it. How can we do that? And now there's twice as much energy being generated towards that goal. Or, well, I see that. I can appreciate that. I would love to support you in that if you will support me in this. And then you get to have a dialogue about that. Is it possible to do both at the same time? Or, oh, I'm not sure. That's what I really am about, and why don't we give it some time to think about it, and you go do your thing, I'll do my thing, and if the universe brings us back together again, we can look at it then. Either way, there's no hurt feelings involved, there's no upset of once we've gotten into the situation, how do I get myself out of this, and our garden continues to get the kind of attention from us that is intended. Tara?
I'd love to add to that. The first time I heard this when going through the program, the idea of going into a meeting with intention, I thought that's pretty bold. And I had a meeting lined up the very next morning with a major company, and it was a new marketing person. And I went in there and I went through what my intentions were. And as soon as we sat down in the meeting, I put it out there. And the relief in her face because she had no clue. She had just taken this position, and she was so glad that I actually had a direction, because I don't think she knew which way she wanted to go. And a lot has come from that initial meeting. And all it took me was being clear with my intention. And since then, I'm very big on, well, what is the intention of our meeting? Because as you do have more and more in your garden, you get more people that they may not even know what they want, and they want to spend time face to face. And as a coach, I get that a lot. And I realize I can't be there for everybody. It's physically impossible. But as I clarify those intentions, I'm able to figure out ways to do that on a bigger, grander level, and a time we both appreciate. There are times not wasted, and my time's not wasted.
Exactly. And that's exactly it. A time waster, an energy waster, a resource waster is not getting that identified up front. So you've had a nice meeting with a nice person, that could have been time that would have been spent either planting another seed or taking a more productive step to produce a sprout, or to actually attend to some activity where that's blooming, like an existing client or customer or a child who really needs attention, because they're already in your life and they deserve to get the best of us. Because that's the other thing that happens. A lot of activity, oftentimes, folks who have not used this program, they've attracted a client or a customer, or they have a child already, and then someone else comes along and they're giving more attention to the newbie, and the one that has been all along starts to feel neglected, less appreciated. That produces its own set of issues. And now instead of continuing to support growth, we're going back to tend droopy. Droopiness is the best way. I don't want to say droopy people. You know what I'm saying? Droopy energy. We have them. Now we have to bolster. And bolstering droopy energy takes more energy than continuing to just support what's already fully in bloom. It's a balancing act. For those of you who are saying, well, yeah, Stacey, that's nice. That's why I've got this program. Are you going to tell me how to balance everything? And I'm saying, yes. Schedule for success, meaning plan the intentional activities, make clear on your calendar, actually write on your calendar why you're having that meeting. Massage therapists, on their calendars, they have massage with, let's just use a name, but with Diane, massage with Diane. It's a to-do. It sounds like a to-do. Where's the energy there? Now, yes, of course, in their mind, they're thinking, I'm going to provide a massage. And oftentimes I say to them, why are you doing that massage? Because I want to give health. I want to give benefit. I receive money from it. Great. Those reasons are intentional activities that will empower you when you write that on your book more than massage with Diane. And why are you putting those intentional activities in? What do you want those funds for? Well, they're going to help me achieve my goal. I want to develop a new website, or I want to have a wellness center. Okay, there's the goal. Why don't you write the goal down? Massage with Diane to generate more funds, give wellness, be known for my wonderful services towards the development of my wellness center. Every time they say to me, now I'm excited about doing that appointment. And Corey just nodded. What did you see there?
I agree. When we were doing this practice and you coached me as far as going into the whys, I have certain things on my list. That was a huge eye opener for me. It definitely brought the worth to it, brought value to it. It made me excited to do it. And, I realized that the why that I usually chose, or the to-do list, was nothing compared to when I came to a why list. I had so many whys and so many reasons to do what I had on my list to do, and it just made it more fun. It made it exciting.
Beautiful. Yes. Our goals are our whys. Our whys are our goals, and the intentional activities are what we do in order to achieve that. That's simple. And when we're clear about why we're doing something, either for ourselves or for someone else or with someone else, then we generate as much energy, as much juice, as much charge as we can get out of that, which propels us forward, following in Michael's rocket metaphor from earlier. So thank you again, Michael, for that. We propelled forward with much less time required to get to that next stage. Let's come into now resting. We've talked a lot about the energy required to develop, to develop, to develop, to bloom. And now, all of a sudden, there's rest. Now, I'm not specifically talking about us taking a rest, the person, because we're going to talk about that later. That's a different energy surge. I'm talking about when the goal stops producing, as we talked about earlier, the blooms stop budding, or the popcorn stops popping, if you will. You know, like, remember Jiffy Pop or in the microwave? There's that burst, you know, little bit, then the big burst, and then trickle, 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 and then nothing, right? If we know that that's the fourth natural part of the cycle, this fourth stage, we plan ahead. We plan for the money that's going to be needed during that stage. We're not left with, oh my goodness, I spent everything when life was booming, and now I have nothing left for the lean times. My husband is a realtor, and there are cycles to real estate. And even as we're recording this program, we may date this here, I'll just say, we're still in a very tough real estate market. Now, we're blessed. My husband and I use the principles of the program, and he's doing well. But even despite that, there is a cyclical nature to when most people buy real estate. The first year, we did it poorly the first year he was a realtor, because we didn't know what those cycles would be. And we didn't know how well he would do during the cycles when things tend to bloom a lot and when they don't. But over these almost, I want to say 9 years, almost 10 years of him being a realtor, we pretty much know when that's going to happen. And we also know when we have to pay taxes, how much to put away for that. And life continues for us pretty consistently. Some months where there's more, some months when there's less, our bills always get paid, because we know when it's booming, that doesn't mean it's going to keep booming all the time. We put the funds aside for that. Yeah, this, I can see you all saying yes. Okay, and so it's no surprise. And that's why I say to anybody who's listening, if you are in life, expect there will be times when things are going to go quiet. It's just the way it works. As Valerie said, it's nature. It's part of the cycle. To be surprised when that happens is almost silly. Not saying you're silly. Just saying that it's kind of a silly idea to think it's not going to happen. Now, there are people who say to me, I'm not working on a goal right now, so is my goal resting? And I say, you're not working, you don't have a be-all? They said, no, I'm just kind of letting life come to me as it comes to me. And I say, well, if you're not working on a be-all, you're not working on a goal, then you definitely don't have a garden. That doesn't mean you've got weeds. It just means you're maybe going around smelling other people's roses. But that is not what we mean by resting. Resting is when the goal itself has come to its natural conclusion for that cycle. And with a little more tending, a little more support, a little more adding nutrients, which sometimes may be us taking a rest, which is why taking our rest is called a rest period, not the rest stage. Without that, it would be difficult for that goal to bloom again. However, it will bloom again, unless, in Valerie's case, once she births this child, she's already told me, you don't intend to birth another. Okay, so the goal of birthing another child, that will be fully at rest as far as you intend, correct?
Right.
Okay. There are some goals that we don't want to have bloom again. We get to choose. But if we do, we can trust it will happen. And as we come to the end of episode number 2, please remember, always do it any way you can. And take time to tend your be-all garden. Be empowered, be powerful, and keep your eye on your be-all.
exciting, inviting, pleasing, wonderful, loving, grand, heavenly, my G to be, awesome.